Okay, so I'm going to apologize for how weird this format is going to be for the next few days, because with training camps all going on at the same time, earlier in the mornings, heading into what is, for me at least, lunchtime in the afternoons, it's a little bit difficult to try to go out there and create a daily show, because the Canucks camp, the Habs camp, all the camps, they're going on at the same time, which makes things a little bit more difficult if I want to go out there and make videos early in the day as I usually do. So this video right here is talking about day one stuff from the Montreal Canadiens and their camp. It is recorded after all this stuff has gone down on Thursday, September 23rd, and it will be uploaded on the 24th at 10 a.m. PDT. By this time the video is uploaded, we might have ourselves some new information that isn't covered here. So apologies, we'll get to it a little bit later, but that is the sacrifice I have to go ahead and make when I decide to go out there and focus my attention to most of the teams in this hockey league and try to talk about them. So today's video is going to talk about the Montreal Canadiens and injuries, because when it comes to the Habs and their Stanley Cup Finals run, one of the biggest things that we had looming over our heads as the season wrapped up and as the offseason commenced was who would actually stick around and who would end up departing the squad. This was a big deal because we had ourselves a whole bunch of discourse going about with contracts, with health, with LTIR stuff, and in a nutshell, we had ourselves an idea in our minds that heading into the 2021 season, we had the potential in losing out on Philippe Deneau. We wouldn't get his services back for the next season. He was really important in the cup run. Jonathan Drouin, who is a cult winger on this team, we might not have had him come back to the team because we didn't really know what was going to go on there. Price and Weber both had injury concerns, and we had Thomas Tatar also hitting free agency as well. Tatar, as everybody loved to go out there and coin the name for. But this Canadiens team was going to look different, no matter how you slice the pudding. We had ourselves what was a really eventful offseason. No more KK, no more Tatar, no more Deneau. Drouin came back, which is great to see. But when it comes to Shea Weber, hey, that sucks. The situation is so unfortunate with what's gone down with Shea Weber that we may not even see this guy play a game ever again. Who really knows? We're going to have to wait maybe like a year or two to see where exactly his career heads down. But Carey Price was another name that we were super conscientious about. We had ourselves the Seattle Kraken expansion draft, wherein Carey Price was actually left exposed. And guess what? The injury concerns that the Canadiens brought up right before the expansion draft served as a big enough deterrent for the Kraken to not take Price. They were able to protect Allen as well. So the goaltending tandem that we had in the season last year, hey, guess what? They're still here. Pretty good to see. But when it comes to one of the guys in particular, Carey Price, maybe it's not there yet. So this was the thing that I'm referring to over here. Eric Engels talking about the Montreal Canadiens and the medical updates from the opening day of camp. Again, this is the opening day. By the time this video is uploaded, there might be some other stuff, but we'll get to it when we get there. The update says here that we are expecting Carey Price, Mike Hoffman, Paul Byron, Josh Brook, and Joel Teasdale to all miss the remainder of training camp. And we had ourselves a bigger update from the Canadiens once this was established. Paul Byron, apparently it's a hip thing. Mike Hoffman, a lower body thing. Joel Teasdale has himself a knee problem. Josh Brook, also a knee problem. Carey Price as well. Guess what? A knee problem. This is the update. They have all failed their physicals and they're expected to miss the entire training camp. Edvinsson is day-to-day. Gallagher is not at camp for family reasons, but he is expected to come in the next few days. So there you go. We had ourselves also a few videos of Edvinsson going around there, shooting the pucks at the blue line, just working out on stuff by himself. Gallagher not being there is a little bit daunting, but of course he is going to come back. Family comes first either way, so regardless, Gallagher has a legit excuse to miss out on the first few days over here. But when it comes to the guys that we want to talk about, let's talk about our players over here that might actually have themselves a little bit of a difficult time when it comes to returning to the game. Missing the entirety of training camp certainly is not ideal, especially for hockey players who play in the style of one Paul Byron. Let's bring him up here first. He's in a position where we might actually see him on the LTIR for a good chunk of this season. This was the entire thing that was talked about with the Kotkaniemi offer sheet. Okay, the Canadiens, they don't really have too much money to spend. They have some money because of Weber on the LTIR, and if Byron goes on the LTIR as well, then there's a little bit more cash freed up. But when it comes to Paul Byron, he's the kind of guy that needs his hips to be at 100%. We all kind of know the way Paul Byron plays out there. He is always going. He is a pest to play against. He's in the corners. He's battling. He is quick. He is shifty. He is small. But when it comes to the way that he plays, he kind of needs the mobility in his hips to be able to function at 100%. So if he spends a little bit more time on the LTIR, hey, that's okay. That is fine, because his $3.4 million certainly is not insignificant. Mike Hoffman with a lower body injury is going to be quite daunting if you're just going to be looking at the pure goal scoring standards of this team. Now, we already know how important it is for guys like Toffoli and Caulfield and Anderson to be the best versions of themselves. They know how to put the puck in the back of the net, and Mike Hoffman is kind of in that similar mold where defensively, you really wouldn't like to see him on a penalty-killing unit, but when it comes to just being the other guy on the power play to absolutely grip it and rip it, I mean, Hoffman does that with no sweat. So if he's not going to be able to go out there and move around the ice properly because his knees are messed up, then, okay, yeah, just give him some time off. Same with Joel Teasdale, you know? Teasdale's a guy that a lot of people don't really know too much about, but the ones who do know about him love this guy to death. He was a really interesting Montreal Canadiens free agent signing. He was a 1999-born, undrafted QMJHL star who was actually really productive with the Laval Rocket last season, 18 points, 26 games played, despite the fact that he missed all of 2019-20. Teasdale has his fans, he works really hard, he's got some really good offensive flair, he just knows how to produce, and this is the kind of guy that, based off of the profile we have seen, he's 22 years old right now, he is more than capable of producing at the AHL level with a full year off. I'm really excited as to seeing where Teasdale could go in his career. So, I mean, the knee stuff, you definitely don't like to see that with Teasdale and the guys after who follow in the same category over here, but I do think that Teasdale is one of the more underrated, undervalued kind of guys in the system, mostly because he has been like a ghost, missing out on that entire season, you know? Like, some people could have easily written him off because, okay, he is 21 years old, heading into the AHL, he just missed the entire season, where in the heck is this guy gonna go now? And, I mean, he went out there and he actually did really well returning. So, good for Teasdale. We hope to see him recover. We hope to see Josh Brook recover, too, because this guy was an absolutely fantastic player in the Moose Jaw Warrior system. However, his start with the Laval Rocket in 2019-20 was seen as a disappointment by some people. He had 75 points in 59 games with the Warriors in the WHL the year beforehand, and in his first pro season, 13 points, 60 games played. But, I mean, come on. He was 20 years old, making his debut in a pro men's league. It's not an easy transition, which is why the way he was able to produce this season, 15 points, 33 games played in 2020-2021, I think is a really good step up. He got the same amount of points in half the amount of games, and he was actually a lot better for it. So, Brook is one of those guys, in my opinion, who has pretty interesting, stable, like, second power play potential. He is a right-handed defenseman, and the Canadiens do need right-handed D, so I'm really interested in seeing Brook in where he goes into the future. I've always kind of been high on him because watching that Warrior squad with Wu, Almeida, Langan, and the other guy, I completely forgot his name right now. Braden Tracy, that's who it was, right? Langan, Tracy, and Almeida. Yeah, that's what it was. They were fantastic, and Brook was part of that, and he was a Canadiens prospect, which made him cooler to me. But we will have to wait a little bit more to see where he goes, especially since he's not going to be here for the entirety of training camp. Carey Price is the big one we saved the best for last over here. It's a lot better, you know? Like, seeing the plan here for Carey Price, this is laid out by Renaud Lavoie. Price was supposed to be 1 week ready before the start of the season, but that won't be the case anymore. The goal now is to have him ready for the start of the season, but only time will tell. Price is in a position where having him just on the team, you know, just being able to say he will likely return at some point in the next few weeks is a lot better than the alternative. Either he wouldn't have come back at all, or he would have been picked up by Seattle. You know, like the scare that we had for Carey Price and whether or not his future would actually be in jeopardy during the Seattle Kraken expansion time was ludicrous. Like, I was actually kind of freaking out internally. Okay, Carey Price is not going to be a Hab. Like, I said that with so much vindication in the video that we made previously talking about Weber, Price, Tatar, Deneau, and Drouin as to whether or not those guys would be off the team, that Carey Price, man, who knows if his era in Montreal has actually come to an end via either Seattle or via just health, you know? Imagine that, making the finals and then just not being able to play anymore? That would have been so devastating for Carey Price, a legendary Canadiens goaltender over here. So, whatever the plan is for him, just make sure he is okay. Whether he comes in game one of the season, game three, game five, whatever, just as long as he is fine, I'm okay with it, even though the plan seems to have changed from having him available 1 week before the start of the season to now being available for the season. Just treat him right, Montreal, I guess. So talk to me in the comments, what do you think about these updates over here for the Canadiens and the guys who are going to be out? Paul Byron, Mike Hoffman, Joel Teasdale, Brook, and Carey Price. I hope you enjoyed this video of Trolls in the I-9. More stuff about training camp will be coming as the week goes on. And bye.